Okay, so hi everybody and thanks for joining the webinar. So as it says on the slide there, so the idea behind the webinar is to talk about monitoring progress on your weight loss journey. So I'm going to turn my camera off so it's not distracting any of the slides, and I'll just carry on talking. I'll pop my camera back on at the end for questions. So what we're going to be going through then, so the content of the session, we're going to be looking at body weight and what makes up our body weight. So we're going to be talking about body composition, having a bit of a breakdown for what that is and discussing some of the topics that we need to be aware of when it comes to taking our weight. We're also going to look at the factors that can influence short-term changes in weight. So what is it that's causing these short-term changes, both up and down in your weight? We're looking at typical rates of weight loss and what kind of things we should be expecting when we're embarking on a weight loss journey. We're going to have a quick chat about how this relates to BMI and where that BMI fits in terms of health and weight loss. And we're also going to look at alternative methods of tracking progress. So it's not all just about taking weight measurements. And a bit of a summary at the end, and we'll have a Q&A session, like Stevie says. Okay, so first things first then, when we're talking about measuring our progress and we're looking at taking a weight measurement, it's really important to have an understanding for what makes up our body mass. So when we kind of, you're talking about weight, that the kind of scientific way we talk about it is more body mass as opposed to just weight. So the two types of mass that we've got our fat-free mass and our fat mass. And a kind of really easy general way to look at this is to think of the fat-free mass as being good weight and fat mass as being the stuff that we want to try and lose. So our fat-free mass is made up of a number of different things. We've also got our bones, so our skeleton, muscles. So we're talking about both our biceps, triceps, all those kind of muscles, our skeletal muscle, but also cardiac muscle. So things like our heart, our organs, so our liver, kidneys, lungs, all that kind of stuff contributes to our fat-free mass. Our skin, which is a body organ in itself, also contains is a big part of our fat-free mass, and also water. And that makes up quite a big part of our fat-free mass, which is quite an important point as we go along. And there's also going to be water in each of these as well. So there's going to be water in our bone, water in muscle, and water in organs in our skin as well. And then we also have our fat mass. So we have visceral fat mass, which is the fat that's kind of stored around our vital organs. So this is the one that's going to be most harmful to our health and the one that we need to be really focused on losing. We also have what we call subcutaneous body fat. So that's the fat that's found underneath the skin. And we also have fat in our muscle cells as well, so intramuscular fat as well. Now, obviously, this is the stuff that we want to be trying to lose when we're on a weight loss journey. Now, we do need some fat mass. It's important for things like hormone production, insulation, also uses a fuel source. So we do need some fat, but this is what we want to be really focusing on losing when we're losing body mass or body weight. And just to kind of touch on water as well. So the body is composed of approximately 60 to 70% of water. So it's a big old chunk of our bodies is water. Around 70 to 75% of our total body water is found in our fat-free mass. And when we're talking about short-term decreases in weight, it's largely going to be down to drops in total body water and fat-free mass. So that's something that's really important to kind of bear in mind as we go along. So what are we actually measuring then when we step on some bathroom scales? So it's all these different factors. So there's a lot of things going on when we're actually stepping on scales. So we're not just measuring weight, we're measuring things like our kidneys, muscle, the water in our muscle cells, bone, total body water, our blood, connective tissue, our visceral fat, subcutaneous fat, our stored glycogen, our intestines and the content of our intestines, the liver. So all these things are being measured when we're stepping on the scales. And some of these are going to be much more sensitive to change than others, and they're going to change more often than others. So we're going to look at some of the things that can cause some of these changes in body weight. So when we look at the factors that can influence this, we're going to kind of split this into two sections. So we've got some nutritional factors, and we've also got a couple of things in terms of physical activity and exercise as well. So I'm going to start off with some nutritional factors. So one of the big things that can influence short-term changes in body mass are going to be our meal choices. So if we have a meal that's quite high in carbohydrates, and we've been having a quite high amount of carbohydrates in the day before we step on the scales, because of the way that carbohydrates are stored in our bodies, once they're broken down, they store as what we call glycogen. So they store as muscle glycogen, but also liver glycogen. And for every gram of glycogen that we have stored in our bodies, there's going to be 3 grams of water alongside it. So if we have a high carbohydrate day, we're going to be storing more body water, essentially. Similarly, if we're having a low carbohydrate day or quite a low carbohydrate couple of days, then our weight might drop down because we've used some of that glycogen and we've used some of our body water as well. Another thing to think about is the fat content of a meal. So the way that fat's broken down, it takes quite a long time to digest. So that digestion rate is going to be affected. So if you've had a high fat meal the night before, you're weighing in the morning, that could affect the weight as well. Sodium or salt intake, if a meal's quite high in salt, because the body wants to really regulate that sodium to water ratio. If we're having high amounts of salt, we're also going to retain high amounts of water. So for instance, when I talk about short term, so like a meal the night before or weighing in the morning, high carbohydrate, high fat, high salt meal will affect that weight in the morning. Another factor to think about as well is the fiber content. So we're talking about fiber, things like vegetables, whole grain carbohydrates, because the effect that has on digestion, it slows it down, which may also increase body water as well. Another factor then is also meal timing. So if we're in the habit of weighing ourselves first thing in the morning, if we've eaten a bit later than normal the night before, say you've got in from work quite late and you've not had your tea until 7, 8 o'clock, because of the way that the body is going to digest that, that may also influence that number in the scales in the morning. So that's something to be aware of. Another factor as well is our hydration level. So as we've mentioned before, the body's made up around 60 to 70% of water. And if we're in a period of actually dehydrated, so we're not drinking enough, the body will start to hold on to water because we're not getting enough. And obviously that's going to affect the weight in the scales and going to hold on to water. So just to remind, it's important for adults to be aiming towards 1.5 to 2 liters as a water intake or fluid intake a day. And another big thing that's going to influence short-term changes in body mass is our intestinal content or our GI tract content. So we're talking about the kind of stools and the urine. So if you haven't been to the toilet for a couple of days, this is going to have quite a big impact on the short-term changes in weight and can influence the number on the scales as well. And another factor is alcohol. So you might find after you've been out on the weekend and you've had maybe a heavy night over the course of the weekend that weight on a Monday morning is higher than it would normally be. So alcohol can cause GI distress. It can cause bloating and that kind of thing. It can also affect our hydration. So it is a diuretic, so it can make us dehydrated, which again is going to affect our water content in the body. And it can also affect our metabolism. So alcohol will play a part in short-term changes in weight as well. Okay. So to move on then to exercise and short-term changes in body mass. So when I'm talking about short-term here for exercise, we're talking like the days after following exercise. So not over the course of weeks and months, but it can often be the case sometimes that if you're starting a new exercise program, particularly if it's resistance training, it can sometimes mean the weight, frustratingly so, can actually go up a little bit on the scales. And this is because when we're doing exercise, we're actually damaging our muscle cells. So we're causing micro tears in our muscles. In order for the body to repair those micro tears, it sends water to the cells and we end up causing water retention as a way to repair that damaged muscle cell. So because of that, water can go up and it can influence the number on the scale. So on a short-term basis, when you're new to doing exercise, you can kind of see these short-term spikes in body weight as you're doing it. And it's important to bear that in mind when you're tracking your weight, when you're starting a new exercise program, you're making these kind of dietary and exercise changes, that this potentially could happen as well. Another factor as well, when we're talking about real short-term, I mean, straight after you've kind of done some exercise or some training, if you've lost quite a lot of sweat during your exercise session, if you were to step on the scale straight away afterwards, you will probably find that your weight has gone down again. Or this is going to be turned when you rehydrate and you start feeding again. But this is an example of making sure that you're regulating the times that you are taking your weight measurement and not taking it a good time, so to speak, so straight after an exercise session. Another factor, again, is that exercise can stimulate bowel movements. So particularly things like low intensity, like long walks and that kind of thing, that can potentially stimulate bowel movements, which again can affect the number on the weight on the scales. Okay, so moving on from nutritional and exercise changes, there are some additional factors that can also cause some short-term changes in body mass. And the menstrual cycle is one of those. So you may find that if your weight goes up slightly just before your period, and that's because of the way that hormones are affecting fluid retention. So you may weigh slightly more at the start of your cycle. That should subside after a couple of days, though. There's also certain medical conditions and medications that can cause fluid retention. So when we're talking about medications, things like blood pressure medication, corticosteroids, NSAIDs such as aspirin, ibuprofen, and naproxen can also cause fluid retention and affect that short-term measurement on the scales as well. So what kind of thing can we expect from our body weight to change? So it's perfectly normal for our body weight to fluctuate on a day-to-day basis. So when we're taking into consideration all those different things that our bodies are made up of, it's perfectly normal for that weight to change slightly. And in a study that's looked at free living conditions, so this is people just going about a day that aren't trying to lose weight, they're not doing any kind of dieting. Body mass can change by as much as 1 to 2 kilograms over the course of a few days. So that's kind of important to bear in mind as well. So when we're talking about a good rate of weight loss long term, it's good to kind of set some expectations to think, well, a good rate of weight loss is around about 0.5 kilo to 1 kilo, or that's a pound or 2 pounds for those that work in the old school measurements. So that's a really good sustainable rate of weight loss. And the reason why that's such a good rate of weight loss is that studies have shown that when you go slow and steady, it's much less likely that you're going to lose really important lean muscle mass. So lean muscle mass is important for a lot of reasons. I think it's probably a bit beyond the scope of this webinar to talk about the importance of lean muscle mass. But as a kind of general guide, it's important that we keep hold of our muscle mass when we're trying to lose weight. And so the reason why this is worked out is that for every 0.5 kilogram or a pound of fat mass that we have in our bodies, we store it. There's 3,500 calories of energy stored in that 0.5 pound or pound of fat. In order for us to lose weight, we need to start using the body's stored energy. And we need to be in what we call a calorie deficit or a negative energy balance. So when we're consuming less calories than we're expending, that's when we'll start to burn off our existing body fat. So if we're to split that 3,500 calories over the course of a week, it results in a daily calorie deficit around about 500 calories. So this 500 calorie deficit is considered to be a modest calorie deficit, which has been shown to maintain muscle mass in the long term. And it's possible to create a 500 calorie deficit whilst making small, long-term sustainable changes to our diet and physical activity. And this is really important because one of the key factors for success long-term when it comes to making body compositional changes or long-term weight loss, it's really important that you be able to stick to your changes because this isn't something that you can just do overnight. It takes time. So when you can build these small changes, small habits, that's when you're going to have the best results in the long term. Okay, so just a quick note. So obviously, as a caveat, this isn't a webinar about how to lose weight, but just to provide a little bit of context to what we're talking about when we're saying energy deficit, you can work out your calorie requirements. So your exact calorie requirements are going to depend on quite a number of different factors. So one of them is going to be your age, you've got your existing weight, your gender, and also your physical activity levels. But as a general kind of guideline, for those that aren't trying to lose weight, it's recommended that you consume around 2,500 calories if you're a male and 2,000 calories for females. So if you're looking to create a 500 calorie deficit in general, males should probably look at around about 2,000 calories a day and females 1,500 calories a day. If you're maintaining that calorie deficit for a long period of time, you're going to lose weight at a decent rate. So just some examples of things that you can do, small changes that you can do to create that 500 calorie deficit. So we're looking at changing your portion sizes, so reducing your portion sizes and consequently your overall calorie intake, either by looking at food labels, changing your cooking methods, making sure you're staying hydrated, fruit and veg intake, and obviously increasing your physical activity as well. So like I say, it's a bit beyond the scope of this webinar. It's not focused on how to lose weight. It's more about how to measure that weight loss. So if we look at some external resources, places like the BDA, which is the British Dietetic Association, they're a really, really good source of reliable information. Obviously, the NHS website's great. The British Heart Foundation is also a really good reliable source. So I'd signpost anybody, if you're looking to find out a topic around nutrition, if you're to Google BDA and to find out some of their fact sheets, they're a really good, useful way and a reliable way to get some information on how to go about creating that calorie deficit. Okay, so is it possible then to lose weight at a faster rate than 0.5 kilo a week or 1 kilo a week? Well, it is possible, yeah, but we want to try and avoid looking at fad diets that cause a large amount of short-term weight loss because they're not going to stand us in good stead for the long term. often the weight that's lost at those times is things like water weight, lean muscle mass, existing glycogen stores. So when we start to eat properly after we finish the fad diet, that weight's probably going to come back on again. And for long-term health, it's like I say, it's really important to maintain our lean muscle mass. So lean muscle mass is actually quite an important appetite regulator, and it also contributes to our resting metabolic rate. And there's evidence to suggest that when we lose our lean muscle mass, because it's so important, our body wants to get it back. So if we've gone through a period of extreme dieting and we've lost lean muscle mass, essentially our hunger is going to go right up, because that body wants that lean muscle mass back. It wants the energy back. So it's going to start craving that energy. So essentially your hunger is going to go up before, higher than it was before, potentially, as a way to try and regain that lean muscle mass. So as we're losing weight, it's important to hold on to that muscle mass and go slow and steady by making these small kind of changes. Okay. So like I kind of said there, short term, big heavy drops in weight are most likely down to loss of body water, reduced intestinal contents, loss of stored glycogen, and also loss of lean muscle mass, which is something that we definitely don't want to happen. So it does take time to do that, and short term increase and decrease in body mass aren't necessarily indicative of body compositional changes. So it's not necessarily showing us that we're losing this fat mass that we want to lose. And it's really important to bear that in mind when you're stepping on the bathroom scales, and not to use one weight measurement in isolation, because there's so much affecting that day-to-day weight measurement. You have to look at trends over the course of the long term. And I've got an example of that, what kind of thing to look at in the next few slides. So I'm just having a sip of water, sorry. So the following data shows a typical weight loss of 6 kilograms over the course of 12 weeks at an average of 0.5 kilo a week. And it's a total body loss weight of 6% of the body weight. So this data is if someone measuring themselves every single day. And you can see on the graph there that those lines are going up and down all the time. So it's really important to emphasize that weight loss isn't linear. It's typical for these body weight fluctuations to happen all the time and on a daily basis. And this is really, really important to bear in mind when we're getting on the scales and when we're using weight to measure our progress. So to kind of break that down, to give an example of that, if you were to weigh yourself at this time point here, you might be really pleased that what you're doing is really working really well. You've lost some initial weight from that starting point and things are going well. And you continue to make those changes. You're feeling great. You're wanting to kind of carry on with those. You might make more changes and then you might step on the scales and your weight's gone up. And that can happen. And that can be extremely frustrating. You're thinking, I've been trying all really hard to do all this stuff. It's not working. Nothing's working. What is the point? And that can really derail a lot of people. It can be really, really demotivating. And we want to try and stop that from happening, because it's important to know that this kind of thing is going on. It's normal for these time points to body weight fluctuations to affect our progress. So if we're just using a weight measurement from 1 week to the next following week or a fortnight's time, you could have captured these like inconvenient time points. It's giving a real false indication of what your actual progress is doing. So if you were to stop at that point, you've missed out on all this future weight loss. So if you take anything away from this webinar, it's to really make sure that you're using your weight measurements in a long-term basis. So you're looking at trends over the long term and never kind of judge your progress on one body weight measurement in isolation, because it's really not necessarily a true indication of what's actually happening. It's really important to trust the process and to make sure and just be believing the fact that the changes you're making are contributing to an energy deficit, which in the long term will result in weight loss that you can keep off. And if we're to look at that on a weekly basis, then you'll see that it's not always going to go down at the same rate. There's some weeks where it might stay the same. It might even go up slightly, but over the course of time, it's going to level out and you will see some weight loss. So some important things to bear in mind when you are stepping on the scales and you're using weight to track your progress. There's certain things you can do to reduce these variables somewhat and to try and keep the measurements consistent. So one of the first things was to make sure that you're weighing at the same time of the day. Now, ideally, that would be first thing in the morning, after a trip to the toilet and before you've had your breakfast, and in the same clothing every single time that you do it, or same amount of clothing. And it's really important to try and keep that consistent. Because if you weigh in at different times of the day, different days of the week, that can all have an impact on what that number is going to be. It might be lower one week and higher the other. So it's important to try and keep it as consistent as possible. So that might lead on to how often should you weigh yourself? And that's really going to depend on personal preference and how comfortable you are in actually stepping on the scale. So for some people that are happy to do it, weighing every single day can be quite a useful experiment to get an idea of your own body's fluctuations, to kind of get a grasp of what your own body's doing. For some people, that might be a complete nightmare and not a chance you're ever going to step on scales every single day. And that's completely fine. We don't need to be get obsessive about it. It's, if you want to use an experiment, you can do, but I can appreciate that not everyone's going to want to step on the scales every day. So something like once a fortnight or once a week are also really good. But it's just really important, like I say, to bear in mind that you have to keep your measurements consistent and to focus on the fact that it's happening over a long term and not just from week to week. So then we'll talk about maybe how useful is body weight for measuring our health. And as we kind of discussed previously, our body weight measurements consist of lots of different factors. So we've got lean muscle mass, bone mass, fat mass, all being captured when we step on the scale. So there are kind of limitations to using a weight measurement purely for health factors. So that is one kind of the big limitations of a BMI measurement. So for general populations, BMI measurements do kind of work out quite well, and it's quite convenient for like healthcare professionals to use BMIs. But on an individual basis, it's not capturing how much lean muscle mass you have or how much fat mass you have. So it's not necessarily the best marker for health status. And there are other things that we can be using. Equally, if you don't particularly want to step on the scales at all, there are other stuff that we can be doing to track your progress. And one of those is going to be a waist measurement. So a waist measurement is really good to do just in isolation. You can do a waist measurement, but a waist to height measurement is also a really good health marker. So you can, if you're measuring your waist, you can go online and Google waist to height measurement, and there'll be a calculator that you can use. So the reason why this is a good health marker is because it takes into consideration our fat distribution. So there is evidence to suggest that where you're storing your body fat can be quite a big indicator in terms of health risk. So the biggest health risk is weight stored around the abdomen. So this is linked to things like type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease and stuff. So that's the kind of body fat that we really want to be aware of and to avoid gathering. And the kind of good rule of thumb is to keep your waist size to less than half of your height to stay healthy. So if you want to take a waist measurement, make sure that you're using it in the right place, and also make sure that you're not digging that tape measure in too tightly, even if you're using it appropriately. So that's the kind of good way to think about using a waist measurement to track your progress and to be as a sign of a health marker as well. You can also use circumferences. So if it's a specific place that you want to lose weight from, things like your arms, maybe your belly button or around your thighs, using that as your sole marker of progress can also be good if that's what you're focused on and you're not too bothered about your weight. Just again, make sure you're not using that tape measure too tightly. And then for other people, photos might be a good way. So it's very, very, you can look very different at the same body weight because of the way that the body's made up. So if you have a different amount of lean body mass, your body might be a completely different shape and look completely different. So if you're taking pictures, that's a really good indicator of progress. Again, to make sure you're keeping things consistent though. So if you're using it in front of a mirror, stand the same distance away from the mirror, try and do it at the same time of the day so you're getting the light in the same amount of clothing, all that kind of stuff, to maintain that consistency. But that can be a really good way to track your progress as well. And then a really good indicator is clothes size. So if your dress size is reducing or you need to start tightening your belt a bit more, this is a really good sign of progress as well. And then probably the gold standard for measuring your overall health is to go about getting a blood test from your GP. So if your HbA1c is reducing, so that's your fasting blood sugar levels, if your cholesterol is going down, if your blood pressure is reducing, then these are really, really good markers for long-term health. And that you can't really get much better than that. And it's not necessarily just about the weight. And there is even evidence to show that improvements in diet and exercise can lead to improved health markers, regardless of lack of weight loss. So even if it's not resulting in big changes in your weight, you can be like rest assured that you are making big changes to your health. So you can be making big improvements to your health if you're making changes to your diet, you're living a... If you have increase in your physical activity, these are going to lead to improved health markers, even if you're not losing that much weight. So that's really important to bear in mind as well. Okay, so just to summarize then, so kind of the big factor to kind of take away from it is that weight loss isn't linear. It's not always going to go down every single week at the same fast rate. So don't let one bad weight measurement demotivate you and derail your progress. Think about using these weight measurements as long-term trends and measure it on a long-term basis. Changes to body composition and fat mass do take time, and it's important to try and think about aiming at fat loss rather than just weight loss. We want to maintain our lean muscle mass when doing this. A good rate of weight loss is around about half a kilo to 1 kilo a week, so that's a pound to 2 pound. You can do this by making long-term changes that you can stick to. So making small changes to your diet, increasing physical activity, making small changes to your nutritional intake is really good. And a really good outcome as well is that 5% of your total body mass, and if you're going from a course of like 12 weeks or even 6 months, that's a really, really good outcome. If you can maintain that 5% weight loss, that's brilliant. So it's important to bear in mind that when you're thinking about how much weight it is typical to lose, particularly if you're focusing on you losing the right weight. And then just to summarize as well, on an individual level, BMI is probably not the most reliable marker for health status. And to get the best gauge of progress, it's important to use as many different things as you can to track your progress. So if you're using a waist height measurement alongside circumferences, as well as photos, as well as blood work, as well as a weight measurement, that's probably going to give you the best indicator for your overall progress when it comes to your health and fitness. So that's everything for me. So thank you very much for listening and taking the time out of your evening to join the webinar. I hope that's been useful for you and helps to provide a bit of motivation for if the scales haven't gone quite right in a certain week. And I look forward to answering your questions. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Liam. That was brilliant. I don't know if you want to stop sharing your screen and then we can see your face a bit bigger. So we've just got two questions at the minute. So if anybody's got any questions at all, pop them in that Q&A and we've got quite a bit of time so we can answer as many as possible. If there's not that many questions, we'll end the session earlier tonight. So this is your opportunity if you do want to ask anything. So Kaylee has asked, does ABL help with recipes in a diet plan? I've been trying to lose weight, but getting really bored with similar foods. You're just on mute, buddy.
Sorry, yeah. So do we help with recipes and a diet plan? So we don't necessarily give out specific diet plans. Diet plans can be a little bit restrictive, and that's the last kind of thing that we want. So we do help when it comes to recipes. We do have a recipe book that we can send out to people. And the kind of best thing that we want to do is to kind of help you make these choices and make the best things that you can for your own kind of nutrition and putting in place things that you can use. So we don't typically give out diet plans per se, but we help to provide the help and assistance for making sure you're getting the right cooking methods, you're planning your meals properly, and all that kind of stuff. Anything you'd add to that, Stephen?
I think I was just thinking we've got some like recipe cards that we could maybe pop in the chat. So I'll have a look at the end of the session when we finished asking questions. I'll keep the webinar going and I'll have a look in the background and see if I can pop them in the chat so people can download it if possible, if they want to. We can also post them on the Facebook group. So if you join your local Facebook group, then we'll be able to put them on there for you. So Julie's also asked, how do we get the recipe book? So if you ask your healthy lifestyle coach or healthy lifestyle advisor in your sessions, they should be able to get you a recipe book. If we give you a hard copy, we do ask for £1 just to cover the cost of printing them. So just be aware of that. But if we've got any digital copies, I think we can just send them out. So again, I'll have a look for that at the end of the session and see if we do have any. Somebody's asked, are body composition scales accurate?
Yeah, great question. So it can be really, really difficult to get an accurate gauge of your body composition. So one of the big factors that's going to influence how accurate they are is hydration status. So even if you're to go like really expensive, like a gold standard, if you're to get on a DEXA machine, which is going to analyze your bone mass and do your composition, they're still not always going to be that accurate because it's heavily influenced by your hydration status and by your water. So if you're standing on like a BIA one, so like a bioelectrical impedance, because of the electrical conduction, if your water is quite high, it's going to influence whether it's going to be high or low or not in terms of your overall body fat percentage. So it's very, very difficult to get a real accurate gauge of your fat mass. It can be quite expensive to go about getting a DEXA as well. You can use like skinfall calipers and stuff, but yeah, I'd be wary of how accurate they are. And kind of, like I say, just kind of bear in mind the long-term changes that you need to be making and looking at that steady kind of rate of weight loss, which is going to hopefully reduce any kind of lean muscle mass and make sure that most of your mass that you're losing is fat mass.
Thanks, Liam. I'm just going to circle back to the question around, do we offer diet plans? So for lots of our, we don't offer specific diet plans, but for our clients that have maybe tried our traditional weight loss methods in terms of making healthy changes, you know, following that Public Health England guidance, and they're not seeing a change, that might be because of some specific barriers you've got, medications, any mobility issues you've got, we do have an alternative diet program, which you might not have heard of yet. So they're things like therapeutic carb reduction and time-restricted eating. So they're two different diet options that we do offer, but we ask that you try a three-month period of that traditional diet or that traditional lifestyle change first. So if that's something you are interested in, again, ask your coach, they can put you on an information session, and that might be quite helpful for you. That's something that we don't tend to talk about very often, Liam, is it? So just wanted to kind of let you know that that is out there. But again, we're not going to give you a specific diet sheet. We're never going to do that. This is behavior change and lifestyle led. So it's all about you making changes that fit in with your lifestyle, but with a more structured kind of approach when we're doing those alternative diets. So Nicola has asked, could you use, I don't know what this is, TDEE to see how many calories we need? What is that, do you think?
So I'm guessing total daily energy expenditure. So it'd be, yeah, you can use calculators online. So if you can go, you could Google how many calories do you need, and you will find different equations that will calculate for you. So you'll just need your height, your weight, your age, and a kind of physical activity level. So an idea of how many like steps you're doing, what kind of physical activity you're doing, how often you're going to the gym, that kind of thing. But yeah, you can Google that kind of thing. Some of them are more accurate than others. Just depends on how well you match up to the equation that's being used. But you can also use it on apps as well. So if you're using MyFitnessPal, it will work it out for you as well. Sometimes if you're using MyFitnessPal, if you asked it to say you want to lose a load of weight, it's going to put you down at quite a low amount of calories. But yeah, you can use equations online to work out your calorie needs.
Brilliant. Thanks, Liam. I'm not sure whether you can answer this question or not, and if you can't, we can maybe direct to the right place. But Sarah said, I'm having problems with gallstones at the minute. I'm trying to adjust my diet to what I can eat and what won't irritate my gallbladder. Do you have any recommendations?
Probably best to see a dietitian with that one.
Yeah, I mean, lower fat's normally helpful in that area, but we're not medically trained, so we need to be supervised by a dietitian when we give that kind of advice. So if you speak to your coach, it might be that we can get you a one-off appointment with one of our dietitians. So yeah, maybe touch base with us that way for that one. Sorry, Sarah, that we can't answer that now. And we've just got one more question. So if you have got any, make sure you pop them in the Q&A for us now. How does managing insulin via diet affect weight?
Okay, so in terms of reducing insulin levels by changing to your diet, so obviously by doing that, you're probably most likely going to be reducing your carbohydrate intake. So it's probably going to reduce your weight because you're reducing the amount of carbohydrate. So that can influence it, like I said before, with the water weight that's stored alongside the carbohydrate. But also, if you are reducing your carbohydrates, it's important that to manage your weight, you do need to be in a negative energy balance. So regardless of whether your insulin is changing, if you're not in that negative energy balance, it's probably unlikely you're going to be losing weight. So that's the kind of the general thing really for weight, is going to be negative energy balance in a calorie deficit. But if you are managing your insulin and you're reducing your carbohydrate intake, it's probably more likely that you do reduce your calorie intake as well.
Thank you. What can you do if you struggle to eat more than twice a day?
Okay, so if you're struggling to eat more than twice a day, if it's an appetite related thing and you just don't feel hungry, maybe try and look at phasing up gradually. So just having a real small kind of meal, maybe depending on the time of day, if it's maybe breakfast that you're not feeling particularly hungry at, maybe just having a small glass of milk and building it up gradually. But if you really don't feel that hungry and two meals a day and an appropriate snack is meeting your calorie needs, then there's no real need that you definitely have to have a certain set amount of meals every day. Obviously, it's great if you can kind of have that traditional three meals a day, but if you're really struggling but you're still making progress, then I wouldn't worry too much about that.
Brilliant. Okay. So somebody said they don't have a lifestyle coach at the minute. How do they go about this? So this webinar is actually open to people from across Greater Manchester. So it might not just be ABL clients here today. So if you, that lifestyle coach or healthy lifestyle advisor only applies if you are an ABL client. So if you're in Oldham, Stockport, Nottingham, Lincolnshire, those areas, then you would have a healthy lifestyle advisor. So if you are, if you've had an assessment and you are waiting for your intervention, you will have your lifestyle coach when you start your intervention. If you've just been if you've just been referred and kind of this has been given to you as an option while you're waiting for that initial appointment, again, you're going to have to wait until you've had that first appointment before you get your coach. But if you want any kind of additional support, as I say, go to our local Facebook pages and kind of get some peer support there, and we'll be there as coaches to pick up any questions you've got. Alternatively, give the office a call. So I'll pop the number in the chat so you can give the office a call if you do want to find out who your coach is, or you want to kind of find out where you are on any waiting lists. I can't remember that number, 1204 570 999, that's it, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, so we've answered that one. You're in Oldham, yeah. So give the office a call on that number I've just popped in the chat, and that should you should get some support there. What about managing menopausal weight gain, Liam? We've actually got a really great webinar from Twani, so I'll drop the link in that while you answer the question.
Yeah, I think Twani is probably best to answer that question as well. So it can be quite a complicated topic, and it's probably best discussing things with your GP as well. But yeah, the webinars that Twani is probably the best place to go about getting that information. Sorry.
I think from my point of view around the menopause, we need to be kind to ourselves and acknowledge that it is a little bit harder when we do start to go through the perimenopause and we move into the full menopause. It's harder for us to lose weight, and we should be going to the doctors and asking for hormone replacement therapy, because it's vital for our health in the long term. And it's up to you whether you the pros and cons of taking it. You need to decide for yourself whether you want to take it, but it is going to be a bit harder. We do need to think about our bone health, and we do need to maintain our physical activity and really probably think about adjusting our portion sizes, because our metabolic rate isn't as high. So essentially we don't use the energy as well that we eat. But I'm going to pop a link to the menopause webinar into the chat so you can have a look at that.
It is okay to be so stressed and
Sorry, I'm a bit slow off the mark there. I feel like I'm out of practice. There we go. So there aren't actually any other questions there, Liam. So I wonder if nobody's got any other questions, then we'll end the webinar there. So we'll just give you a second to see if anything is posted in the Q&A box. Liam, I was just wondering if you got the link to the session survey, feedback survey.
I'm not sure.
I haven't. If you can find it, will you pop it in the chat?
Yeah.
Somebody said, please confirm the phone number. I've typed it in the chat. So if you scroll up the chat, it is there. But it's 01204 570 999. Thank you. So we've got a poll. We've got a poll just to kind of get an idea of what the sessions are you would like to see going forward. So if you just take a minute to answer that, that'd be brilliant. And while you're answering that, I'm just going to answer Nicola's questions. The links are in the chat. So if you click on the chat box at the bottom of your screen, Nicola, that's where you'll find the links. Scroll up, I'll pop them in there for you. But alternatively, if you go to YouTube and just go to type in ABL Health, and then there's a go to playlists, and there is a playlist called webinar series. When you go onto that, scroll down and you'll find Let's Talk About Menopause, and then Let's Talk About Menopause Part 2. Okay. So these questions are just asking where you've kind of, which area you've come from, how would you rate the session today, and then what other topics would you like to hear about going forward? So we're just, that'd be really helpful for us. So I can see some of you have clicked. That'd be really helpful if a few more of you could fill that in for us, if you don't mind. I think, Liam, that is all the questions for today. So thanks so much. I really enjoyed that. It's always nice to be reminded of all the different ways we can monitor ourselves, isn't it? I think even ourselves, we get out of practice sometimes, don't we? And if we're not feeling great, it is good to just look at what you're eating, how it kind of compares to the your mood and that kind of thing, isn't it? Even at a minimum. So thank you for that refresher for me as well.
Thank you.
No worries. Right, I'm going to just I'm not going to end the webinar just yet. So I'm going to look for some resources in the background, Liam. But if you want to leave, that's fine. I'm just going to turn my camera off.
Right, great. Yeah.
Give people chances to finish the call. All right. Thanks, everybody. Have a lovely night.